Hello. Wow, it's a packed room. How's everyone doing? Whew. Man, it's a lot of people. Where'd everyone come from, just out of curiosity? New York, DC, Brazil, DC, Boston, Texas. Who's from Texas here? Glad we got a good crew. Before we even get started, first I want to thank our Golden Gate sponsors, Bluehost and Dreamhost. Great host, I both use. And then two, go ahead and raise your hand if you are a volunteer at WordCamp San Francisco. Let's give a round of applause for these folks. Without them, it would not be nearly as smooth as it has been. And you guys have been having a good time the past day and a half, right? Yeah. All right, all right. Well, I guess without further ado, it's time for the 2013 State of the Word. So, my name is Matt Mullenweg. I say that every year. If you want to tweet me during this, my Twitter is @photomat, and my blog is, of course, ma.tt. Today we continue our annual transition. It's actually the 8th WordCamp San Francisco. Right? It's funny to think back to when it started because we did it with about 3 weeks of planning. We announced a date before we had a venue, and about 300 people showed up. I recommend for WordCamp organizers out there, don't announce a date before you have a venue. But I brought some cool photos from it just to kind of look back because it's been so long. We put a t-shirt over a parking sign so people could find it. Registration actually had a line around the block, not because there were so many people, but because we decided to print out the badges when people arrived. Like as they arrived. Networking was very sophisticated. As you can see, we had the finest in Linksys consumer grade materials. There weren't seats for everybody, so lots of people sat on the floor. But it was a lot of fun. You know, we had a great time by all. We even had a little bit of music. And I had a lot less hair at the time, if you can believe it. But from then until now, the ideas of WordCamps have remained largely the same. The idea was a simple, low-cost event that all around the world, people could come to either learn about deep technical topics, like perhaps Mike Adams or Nikolai's talks you might have seen, or user topics, so how to become a better blogger or photographer or whatever it is that you're putting into that WordPress-powered blog. The rest we've been kind of figuring out as we go along. We prefer local events to regional ones to try to get people to connect more. Again, we try to keep it as low cost as possible. We try to have cool t-shirts, of which I see lots of. In the audience. In fact, when you go to the Automatica office tomorrow, we have an actual t-shirt museum. So we've been trying to collect t-shirts from all the WordCamps around the world and just kind of display them in a cool, artistic way. Just out of curiosity, who is here at the first ever WordCamp? Bo, put your hand down. All right, I'm going to call that survey not accurate. Let's turn it on. Who's been to more than 10 WordCamps? More than 20 WordCamps? This year. It's possible. There have been over 314 WordCamps to date, 72 this year alone. Here's what blew me away, though. Who can guess how many unique speakers there are at WordCamps? 1,026. In just the past year. So that's just the past 12 months. And then finally, this blew me away even more. There's been over 1.4 million views of the WordPress TV WordCamp videos. So no pressure if you're a presenter, but these get viewed way more than even the sometimes intimidating number of people that are in the room. So what else have we been up to? In terms of, some of you might remember from the hangover the following day, we celebrated our 10th anniversary on May 27th. As far away from Austin, Texas to Hanoi, Vietnam, there were celebrations all over the world. I think we had 4,999 people show up at them, according to meetup.com. So, I mean, I don't know where that last person was. That's all we needed. But it was totally surreal. Yeah, wasn't that neat? And then this, I think, was the plug-in piñata. Some people were at that party. It was so surreal, not just a piñata, but to see pictures streaming in from around the world, basically over a 24-hour period, coming from this thing that Mike Litt and I helped get started, you know, a decade ago, as it aged into the double digits. I can say with 100% certainty that neither of us would have ever predicted there would be a WordPress piñata being beat around. So, sort of a year in review. Besides turning 10 years old, what else have we been up to? Well, of course, there was the Elven release, which was very popular. We finally redid media. We did a 2012 theme, so here's the new media. We did a 2012 theme, and we also did our first pass at making the admin crisp on Retina devices. Now, I know there's been a lot of questions and rumors about the 3.6 release. Almost as many about Jay-Z and Justin Timberlake being at the after party tonight. For a variety of reasons, we're not going to release 3.6 this weekend. We're here to have a good time. Not that doing a release isn't a good time, but we are going to do something a little bit different, which is for the very first time ever, we're going to do a world premiere of the 3.6 release video here for you guys here in the room. You ready for that? All right, let's dim the lights. Make it a little darker in here. We should put some music on, right? Let's get it on. Here we go. We tried to do a little something different with this video. You saw that, right? If we could have Mark Jaquith and Aaron Hockley, where are you guys? Aaron Campbell, the leads for 3.6. So So that will be out, and I hope I'm not saying anything untoward, very soon. And as you might have noticed, Oscar is the jazz name we chose for this, for the great Oscar Peterson. So we also had a number of updates to WordPress.org over the past year. Some of the big ones were, of course, the make.wordpress.org blogs, where we've had over 10,000 posts and comments over the past year. So huge, it's more than doubling from last year. Some of you who are plugin authors, wait, who is a plugin author here, just out of curiosity? Man, that's a good, they always make fun of me when I say the percentage of the audience that raises the hand, so we'll say that's 90% of the audience. With a new plugin review system, so now all ratings are attached to reviews, meaning that no one can just give you a one star without saying why it's a one star. And every single one of those reviews is now a thread that you can respond to, and the original poster can change their rating later. This has been really exciting to watch because I've seen a lot of those one stars turn into five stars. And I've also seen plugin authors become a lot more active in sort of the forums surrounding their plugins. So it's funny how just like one little change, I mean, this wasn't that much code behind it, has had a big impact on behavior. And in the future, we're going to actually retire the way ratings work, and they will be 100% driven by plugins. So we'll do kind of a plugin review ratings reset. And I think Otto knows the exact number. I think we've had over 50,000 of these so far. Is that about right? 40,000. So over 40,000 of these has been done since it sort of soft launched. And then finally, which some of you might have read, we released the first chapter of WordPress the Book, as in the history of WordPress. First of many chapters to come, but something we're doing that's a little bit different is this is the first book, at least the first book I've been involved with, that's written on GitHub. So you can actually see the change history and make pull requests and everything for the text that's being written for the history of WordPress, which I think is very appropriate that the book is being done in a similar way to the software itself. And that is Siobhan and Krista are working on that. So a round of applause for them. Some other activity on the core project, we had over 46 million downloads, or about 147,000 every day of the year, which always blows me away. We added 336 themes, or about 2.3 times the number we did last year. And it's worth noting that every single one of these goes through the theme review process. So there's a lot of review for every single one of these coming in. And then 9,300 plugins were requested, 6,700 approved. I apologize to the other 3,000 or so. It's probably spam. But it's been great to see we finally passed 26,000 plugins on the directory. So, I mean, it's really starting to tick up the number of things available there. The final thing I wanted to highlight was the mobile apps have been doing well. We had 15 updates of the mobile apps, 3 for iOS and 6 each for Android and Windows Phone. So these are starting to get better faster, which I am pretty excited about. Every year when we talk about contributors, we like to highlight a few folks, some of the new faces in the community, sort of the introduce them to you and the world watching on the web right now. The first I want to talk about is actually a square. We have Constantin Squared, and Mr. Koch. Next we have Mike and Adam, and this picture of Adam was taken hours ago. So you can look for that man. He will be wearing that exact outfit. We had Scott and Drew. Is he a superhero? Is he a WordPress contributor? We're not sure. And then finally, Dave Martin and Johan Asmussen on the design side. Every year we also talk about the survey. We had over 30,000 responses this year from over 178 countries. As always, I like to ask people what a few of their favorite things were. Raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens did not make the cut. But community and ease of use were still top of people's minds. And on least favorite, once again, plugins takes the crown. I guess those 26,000 plugins, some of them were causing trouble. I also like that nothing was on there. But the runners-up were updates and security. We asked a new question this year that I was pretty curious about, which was, what devices do you use to access WordPress? And this was multiple choice. So for example, if I answered this, I would have said, I use WordPress on the web, on an iPad, on the iPhone, and an Android phone. And so this is what those numbers turned out to be. And I found them pretty interesting. They fly in. So of course, well, I found it interesting on the edges. The middle I would kind of expect it. First, I'm wondering who the 2% that don't use it on the web at all are. That's interesting. And how did they take the survey? I guess they took it on their phone. And then at the right, I found it interesting that 12% are using WordPress from a desktop app, like Mars Edit. That's way more than I would have expected. So this is a non-browser desktop app. And then also, you know, everything I've heard or read in the news about Android tablets has been that they're dead on arrival. And so I was pretty surprised to see that 18% of people are using WordPress from an Android tablet. Anyone in this room using an Android tablet? Right now? Nice. I think that we said Fire in there, so that should include a Kindle Fire as well. So the next, we of course have asked the standard question, what do you use WordPress for? Which is always interesting to look at year to year. So I've included both last year and this year's on there. So we both had CMS up use a little bit, blog hybrid use down a little bit, blog only use down a little bit, and then a new entry, which is using WordPress as an application platform, which is now at 7% of the 30,000 people. So that's, you know, over, what's that, 1,500 people using WordPress mainly as an application platform. And it's kind of funny, when we first started talking about that a year or two ago, I said we're at the very beginning of this cycle. So it's nice to see that start to pick up, and I expect that to sort of approach the hybrid blog CMS numbers. We did one additional thing this year. Actually, we didn't do it, but our fine friends at WP Engine did. And they did a sort of broad, statistically valid, representative sample of United States adults and asked them one question. Have you heard of WordPress? I think they asked them some other questions as well. But this is basically what's called like a brand awareness thing. And just under 30% had. Now, I haven't decided if this is a good or bad thing yet, but it does match the anecdotal data I've been getting from flying on planes and having seatmates. Now about 1 in 3 people don't look at me like I'm so crazy or wonder why I have WordPress all over my body. Like, what's that W thing? So that's nice. Again, I don't know if this is good or bad, but it'll be interesting to see as a baseline for years coming, whether we'll be able to maybe bring, I feel like 1/3 is pretty mainstream already, but whether we can take it to even more mainstream, you know, like Justin Bieber levels. Without the monkeys. See, there's some Bieber fans that follow that monkey story. He apparently had a monkey, and he took it to Berlin, and the monkey got stuck in customs, and he left the monkey there. Right? Oh, don't boo. Oh, sorry, just that slide again. And then finally, which is the kind of main measure that we use to track our progress on our main goal of democratizing the web, we are now up to 18.9% of the web running WordPress. Yeah, this number just blows me away every time. And it's actually broader than it used to be. It used to be a survey of the top 1 million sites, and now it's a survey of the top 10 million sites. So that is as good as you're gonna get. Now this data is all awesome, and I think we should be very happy about the progress we've made the past year. But I think there is some danger lurking behind the numbers. Oh, you can't see it, that's a bomb. Oh man. Last year at WordCamp, there was a presentation in the morning that I think was one of the most important presentations given at WordCamps, and including my own, about my own. It's from a local product guy named Nir Eyal. I'm gonna butcher what he talked about, but if you wanna see the real version, you can check out his presentation on WordPress TV. And of course, he has a site, nearandfar.com, right? It's the only way I remember how to pronounce his name. That's really excellent. It's actually one of my favorite blogs to follow. Before I talk about what he talked about, first we're going to do a survey. It actually wasn't that long ago that at a WordCamp, I asked who had a smartphone and less than half the room raised their hand. Like, it's easy to forget that the iPhone's only 5 years old. And before that, we all had don't know, Treos or Blackberries. But so I'm going to assume everyone has a smartphone. We're going to do a different survey. Who has ever felt a phantom buzz? Right? How about when, like, your friend's phone buzzes and you reach for your pocket? Or, like, something, the table vibrates a little and, like, everyone kind of spazzes out? And then, of course, there's the new yawn of the world, which is where one person at the table takes off their phone, and then everyone else does. Kind of becomes like that sort of shared thing. It's contagious. So it turns out there's a study done at Indiana University, and 89% of undergraduates experienced a phantom buzz in the last 2 weeks. And it turned out, they don't know exactly what causes this, but it turns out that the more emotional significance you attach to whatever causes your phone to buzz, particularly text messages, the more likely you are to experience them. Which I found kind of crazy. It's almost like these are now parts of our body that we feel weird when they're not there, right? Let's be honest, who has looked at their phone since this presentation started? Oof. All right, I'll try to spice it up next year. More guys with huge beards, right? I don't know if you saw, but my favorite part of the video, and we actually tried to boost the audio so it came out a little bit, but after they did the high five, they snapped. Which is awesome. So Nir has a theory of why he talks about this happens that he calls Atari. The A is a little bit of a cop-out. The A stands for a hook has four parts. But the Atari part is pretty interesting. A T is a trigger. A stands for action. R stands for reward. And I for investment. A trigger can be internal or external. An external trigger is something like your phone buzzing, maybe seeing a sign when you're driving down the street and deciding to do something, or getting an email notification that you have a new comment available on WordPress. An internal trigger is usually a feeling or a state of being. Tired, lonely, bored, hungry, hangry. Does anyone ever get that? Those are internal triggers that you have a default response to. Like, for example, let's say you're lonely, and so you go to Facebook. Now, your brain does these without even thinking. They're an automatic response. When they do brain scans, they don't, the part of the brain that shows sort of active, what's it called? There's a word, autonomous something. The high-functioning part of the brain doesn't actually engage. Like, literally, it's just the part in the middle, the lizard brain, that just kind of goes straight to things. And an interesting thing happens. Like, let's say you got a comment notification, your buzz phone, because you're buzz phoned? You're buzz phoned. Or your phone buzzed because you got a comment notification from Buzz Lightyear. And you want to read it. You click the WordPress icon. It turns out that the dopamine hit to your brain, the reward center, activates before you get the reward. It's the anticipation of the reward that causes it to kick off. When you actually receive the reward, like say that wonderful comment from Buzz Lightyear, the rewards, the dopamine actually goes down, and that part of your brain doesn't activate as much, which is really fascinating. The second thing, as we all learned from the experiments from Skinner and everything else, is that the rewards are most effective when they're intermittent. So let's say, for example, there could be a comment from someone you like, or an email notification of, let's say, you know, your paycheck has been deposited in your bank account. Or a notification saying a Nigerian prince would like to deposit something into your bank account. These have different value. And that's part of what makes these systems so addictive to us all, is because when that phone buzzes and you start to take it out and the dopamine hits, by the time you open it, it's not every single time that you get the paycheck deposit, right? Unless you're only checking your email once or twice a week or once every 2 weeks. Then finally, there's the I, the investment, and that's making it your own. Now, the best way to think about this is, who here has ever built IKEA furniture? You get all those parts and like the inscrutable directions. You work and like you're trying to fit things together, and like you finish and you kind of take a step back and you look at it. It's a little crooked. And you have a few extra pieces you don't think you should have. But darn it, you made that. And it feels good. I've actually moved IKEA furniture across the country. It's cheaper to trash it and buy a new one than it is to actually move it across the country. It turns out that this is part of the investment. When you work on something, you are far more attached to it. They did a study with origami, where they had a professional origami maker, doing the paper. It looked amazing. And they had people make their own origami. And then they had third parties rate both of them. So the professional guys were obviously 100%. Everyone liked it. It looked amazing. So the people who made their own, they rated their own origami as about 90% the value of the professional. The third party, independent auditor of this origami skills, rated it at about 10%. So we overvalue our own work about 9 times what the rest of the world sees it as. You can also think about this if you spend hours looking for the perfect header for your Facebook profile that perfectly describes your personality. Or you spend hours sifting through 26,000 plugins to find the one that's perfect for your site. These investments make you far more attached to the results. So I think it's interesting to think about habits, loops, hooks, and triggers in the context of users of WordPress. What if someone never touches code? What if someone's a developer? What if someone's a plugin release? What are the hooks for that? This is one sort of idea of a WordPress hook for a user. You can have an idea, get inspired, that's a trigger. Your first impulse is to write. So you log into WordPress, you write, you publish it, and then you start to get the feedback. That can be the reward, and sometimes these posts you spend a long time on, no one comes to. I actually hate that. It's always the posts that you fired off in 5 minutes that get all the hits, and the ones you spend hours and hours over that just fall like a thud on a log. Is that a thing? And the investment is the time you put into it, but also sort of value stores. So things like number of subscribers, things that go up all the time that sort of are a representation of all the time you've invested into this platform. So let's say your Twitter followers or the subscribers to your blog are sort of a representation of all the time you've put into your blog or to tweeting or something like that. I've been actually getting a lot of inspiration from the mobile apps around this. Not because of the small screen size or anything, but also partially because of the shortened attention span that people have when on their mobile devices or when listening to a State of the Word and looking at the mobile devices. These constraints breed creativity. And if you look at sort of the evolution of where the apps have evolved to, they've really honed in on a few key experiences. Yes, you have the standard WordPress stuff around writing and designing, but a lot of the evolution and what has kept people coming back to the apps have been things like the reader, which is a cure for boredom. Stats, which is sort of an ego feeder. Notifications, which is basically all triggers, right? As these features get better and better, I think that we're going to see the number of people for whom WordPress is part of their daily habits, like many of us here in this room, or at least part of our Saturday in San Francisco habits, grow exponentially. The mobile team has actually grown a lot this year as well. And so we're going to see the features there coming faster and better. As we saw, we already had 15 releases over the past year. I think that's actually going to go a lot up in terms of major new things coming to the mobile apps. And I've seen an interesting shift, which is something we haven't seen with the mobile apps before, which is the mobile apps being for basically existing WordPress users to shifting to actually bringing an entirely new audience into the WordPress experience. So when you think about it, the mobile apps loop sort of shows the consumption, which is the notifications, the reader, the production, which is the writing, and then the management. We did our first iteration on the NUX, what we call the new user experience of iOS. And overnight, we tripled signups coming from the iPhone device. And so that's that 2% that maybe never uses the web to access WordPress. This is undeniably a new generation of people who will be using WordPress, especially as we democratize publishing in parts of the world where maybe laptops or tablets aren't something that people use. That's something that's going to happen. So, like we said, we saw that 7% using WordPress as an application platform. I got this video sent to me the other day by Brian Richards that I thought was pretty cool. We can dim the lights again. That shows WordPress being used as an application platform in a way that I never would have imagined. I hope it illustrates to you some of what's going on. Sexy time lights? All right, there we go.
You use credit to claim rewards, but you will always keep your badges. When you redeem rewards at the DMA, a voucher will be printed at the kiosk where you signed in. Each reward is unique, and each voucher will have printed instructions that explain how to...
This part isn't important. She's buying something.
On your next visit to the DMA, stop by the kiosks to become the newest DMA friend. Start earning credit.
Everything you see on the iPad there is WordPress powered on the back end. And what you don't see is see the camera at the top of the iPad? What people can do is they can actually hold their membership card in front of the iPad, it scans it, and then pulls up their profile. It's all WordPress on the back end. There's not even a website, right? That's really something. It was on this very stage a few years ago when we first introduced the concept of WordPress as an application platform. And we showed something much like this. So we're talking about the evolution of WordPress, saying, you know, 2003 to 2007 was WordPress as a blog. 2008 through 2012 or 2011 was sort of WordPress as a CMS. And 2012 onward, next five-year trend, will be WordPress as an application platform is sort of the dominant thing. I think that's wrong. Don't get nervous. Basically, I just think that we've been thinking about this the wrong way. We've been talking about this in a serial fashion, as one thing leading to another. And I think actually what's going on is all three are happening simultaneously at different levels. And in fact, if you think back to the very first release of WordPress, there are elements of WordPress as an application platform, perhaps around the database layer, the user login system, elements of it as a CMS, you know, with 1.5, introduction of pages and themes, and of course, blogging from the beginning. Of course, the first version of WordPress looked kind of like this, like an upside down pyramid. The platform part was not very solid, and so we were somewhat unstable in how we were able to build things on top of it. But this is now more of how I think about this sort of blog platform, blog CMS platform evolution. And in fact, more than just a pyramid, it's almost like the WordPress platform is something that we're plugging in different things. So CMS is one of the applications, or blog is one of the applications of CMS. There's also e-commerce. And there'll be other things built on top of it in the future. I think this will be, you can plug in every single feature we've ever put into WordPress into one of these three layers, and pretty much every single plugin into one of these three layers, or possibly one of these gray Legos. There's a Lego theme. Who saw Siobhan's presentation with all the Legos? That was awesome. I don't know why I'm a chicken, though. So, there's a history of WordPress illustrated with Lego people, and the Mike Little character was like 100 years old, which I felt bad about, because he was like 30 when WordPress started. And I'm a chicken, like full on wings for arms. I tried to find a chicken suit for you guys, but there weren't any with the WordPress logo on it, so. every single thing falls into these three, which kind of brings us to talking about 3.7. Now, the first thing I'm going to tell you about 3.7, which will also be the most shocking and surprising, is that it's going to be released in the beginning of October. What? That's what I said. It's going to be a platform-focused release, so working on that bottom layer, the WordPress as an application platform, led by Andrew Nason and John Kay, who are both here. Andrew, John, please stand up. And the focus is going to be stability and security, as evidenced by things like language packs, auto updates for minor releases, and enhancements around passwords to make passwords and cookies more secure. The reason we think we're going to be able to do this so quickly is that a lot of this is already done as a plugin. We're also going to use the 3.0 release to sort of reset things a lot. So for example, there's now over 3,800 tickets open on track. So we definitely want to do a little bit of cleanup there, because that is a larger number than we were comfortable with. That's the highest it's ever been in WordPress. But also making some new developer resources. So we are announcing for the first time developer.wordpress.org, which looks kind of like this if you visit it. There's nothing there yet. But basically, the idea is to show like a function reference for WordPress, essentially, that's powered by the code in PHP doc versus powered by people editing the codecs. And the idea is that we'll both be able to redirect codecs pages to sort of an always up-to-date version of this on developer.wordpress.org, and also link in WordPress 3.7 the function definitions, when you edit things in the plugin or theme editor, directly to this developer resource. So, should be pretty cool. These underlying components aren't as sexy from a user point of view, but I think they're really, really important for that platform story and allow us to build things on top of it. And so to talk about what some of the things that we might be building on top of it, first I want to tell you a story about MP6. Now, when we started the 3.6 cycle at the beginning of 2013, from then to now, there were two major features pulled out. One was sort of a refreshed icon aesthetic, and the other was post formats. The icons were pulled out in February, post formats in May, and the icons were something I'd sort of taken responsibility for, so that's why I wanted to talk about it. So historically, WordPress didn't have any icons or graphics in it, zero, partially because we didn't feel like there were any open source ones that represented us, and also, we didn't really have anyone who knew how to make them. So, you know, that was a bit of a blocker. Jen had the idea around the 2.7 redesign to do a contest for people to submit them, GPL license icons. And we got some pretty interesting submissions. This is actually a few of the submissions that came in. You will recognize, this is around Crazy Horse, if you remember that. You will recognize the one on the right because it was from a gentleman named Ben Dunkel, who I believe is here in the audience. Ben, where are you? Oh, hey. By the way, find me later. I haven't had a chance to talk to you yet, so let's hang. This man has single-handedly designed not just all the icons in WordPress, but pretty much all the major icons for any WordPress plugin or product around everything. When I pitched a flatter aesthetic for 3.6, I knew that when we did icons, it wasn't just going to end there. Much like, let's say, when you clean a room, like say you clean off the countertops and sweep the floor, then you look around and you realize that you need to paint the walls. And then once you paint the walls, you look around and you realize, man, the furniture is all in the wrong place. And then once you move the furniture around, you realize, man, I don't need that wall to begin with, and you knock it down. So, and that's kind of what happened with MP6 a little bit, where if I were to rank order in importance the most important things to bring into WordPress, icons would pretty much be at the bottom of it. Not that important. But I knew that bringing those in would force us to deal with resolution independence, with perhaps responsive design. And this is some of the things. Well, this is just a comment of it being taken out March 1st. I try to set a good example for when things are behind schedule. I'll pull them out early. So the first thing I did was create the team. I pinged Matt Thomas and said, what are you doing this week? and he said he'd be up for taking a pass through core. Otto, Johan, and Ben joined. Ben was already working on this. And I started cranking on it and registered a plugin called MP6, the meaning of which is still a secret, and I will not reveal. Has nothing to do with Justin Timberlake or Jay-Z, by the way. But over the next 17 weeks, we did 17 releases of MP6 and iterated to include a number of things. It worked, I think, for 7 reasons. At the time, in hindsight especially, I feel like taking it out of core so early, you know, in kind of end of February, for a release that's just coming out this week, maybe it was premature. It wasn't as behind as we thought it was. One of the main reasons was, for example, we hadn't had all the icons for WYSIWYG done yet. We didn't feel like there'd be time before the release to finish. But it turned out, though in hindsight, maybe didn't need to, it ended up being the best possible thing for the project because it was able to operate as like a core thing but outside of core, which revealed a number of interesting dynamics. The first was we designated very, very clear leadership and a core endorsement. So both core said, and the MP6 group said, okay, MT, who's a designer I've worked with for 7 or 8 years now, very talented. He's designed a lot of WordPress.com, WordPress.org. He worked a lot on the 2.7 redesign. He's kind of like my Johnny Ives. Like, we brain meld in a lot of ways. The entire core team agreed that whatever MT said would go in, would go in. Meaning that it wouldn't, because naturally the core team, being a very diverse and different group of people, has different opinions on aesthetics and everything. And we didn't want this to get bogged down in a design by committee or anything like that. So having a clear leadership was really important. You'd think it would be disenfranchising for the contributors, but it turned out it was actually really exciting because you only had one person to convince. There wasn't like an amorphous community or anything like that, or you weren't sure if we had to take a vote or whatever it was to make a decision, just a single person making the decision. Second was we focused on process over outcome, meaning that I actually said to him, like, well, I think I have the chat here. I think the chat has a slide or two later. But basically I said, let's just do a release every week and change something every single week, ship a new feature. And then I modified that and said, well, maybe let's just change one thing. Maybe it's not a new feature. And then he said, well, let's just try to change one thing. But no matter what happens, every Friday we're going to do a release. Monday through Thursday, or often Monday through Friday afternoon, we'll work on this. And then sometime before Friday is over, we'll put it out there. That worked really well because it meant that if you were doing something, well, one, because it was a plugin that people could download and use, they were able to test it really easily and we got a ton of feedback. And two, it was never more than 6 days from when you put something in to when it was actually in front of the world, for better or worse. But that tighter cycle really was nice. Next is something that I'm not sure was a good thing or bad thing, but it was a thing, which is the chat happened on Skype. So there was the chat room of all the people involved. It was kind of an asynchronous, always on, and people would log into it from different devices. So generally we do things on IRC. For whatever reason, this started and kept on Skype. I'm not saying that we should do this ever again, but it was interesting the dynamics it sort of encouraged. So for example, I felt like people were more comfortable sharing things or putting more vulnerable things out there without worrying about someone from the world seeing it or drive-by feedback or even sometimes the negative comments that you can get on the make blogs. That sort of safe space allowed at least the creative group of designers behind MP6 to kind of feel like have a more iterative and open process certainly between them, and made it more likely for candid feedback between folks. Where if it was on a public blog, you might not be willing to say, man, that's ugly. Because it's someone who you like, you don't want to insult your buddy. But privately, if it's not in front of anyone, those sort of conversations can happen. Like I said, the feedback was really tight. And then finally, we opened it up to anyone that was passionate. So started with four, it's ended up with over 14 committers. And the plugin was very, very active. In fact, when Nason ran the stats I think 6,000-ish, 6,500 people that have committed plugins. Basically, in the past 4 months, Matt Thomas became number 28 of all those 6,000 that have been active in the past year. Finally, I mean, the best and brightest design minds in the WordPress world were involved with this, as you could tell from this header. As you notice, just to point out all the levels of awesomeness here, you have Papyrus and Comic Sans. You have the Fogo with a rainbow gradient. And for the typography nerds, a widow and the word on its own. Pretty much tried to lens flare. We put kind of all the awesome we could in there. In some ways, this was a joke because we were saying, don't use MP6. We were telling people not to test it to get them to test it. But it also, that element of fun brought the group together a little bit. And I think that's also something we should think about going forward is how do we, because sometimes with localization, internationalization, and everything, we lose some of the inside jokes in the WordPress code base. You know, you're cheating, huh? Or Ghostbuster references, Keymasters, things like that. Some of that gets kind of sanded out. And I think some of those rough, sometimes funny, sometimes not funny edges are nice. In fact, the Matrix thing has been removed, right? There was a Matrix Easter egg that we removed when we did the revisions iteration. Has everyone seen the Matrix Easter egg? Anyone not seen the Matrix Easter egg? Oh man, it's cool. So do it in the next day or two. have a post with revisions and compare the revision to itself. The radio box lets you compare something to itself. And I won't tell you what happens next. So it went well. We ended up with some resolution independent icons. This is sort of a before and after. Because we completely got rid of all the sort of 7 or 8 years of accumulated CSS in the admin and redid it from scratch, it's now trivial to do things like change the colors of the admin. This is not core, but this is about 25 lines of code to completely change the colors. So if you don't like the dark look of MP6, it's very easy to change that. We also made it fully responsive. So this should start moving in a second. So now the menu goes to the little hamburger on the top. Boom. You might be wondering why that's called a hamburger. It's called a hamburger button because it has the three layers, and I guess it looks like a hamburger. That's not a good, I don't know why everyone calls it a hamburger button. Like, it would have been cool. Actually, like, in my mind, I call it the Samo button. You know, the artist Basquiat? He did the three lines. He never put the vertical line on his E. I also was on the cover of Jay-Z's Blueprint 3 album. So from now on, let's call that the Samo button. His graffiti name was S-A-M-O for same old stuff. So made it responsive. Like I said, it looks great at any size. I think that this sort of illustrates the power of plugins. Plugins, even just looking at the stats around WordPress, we've had about 1,500 people who have been active in WordPress core development over the past year. That's leaving comments on track, patches, commits, everything. We've had over 6,500 who have committed to a plugin. And of course, plugins are easier for people to test, where sometimes it might be a struggle to get someone to, you know, apply and run your patch and test it. Saying one-click install a plugin is really easy. And as we all know, usage is oxygen for ideas. This is something I say and truly believe, that you don't really know how something's going to work until you get people really, really digging into it and using it every single day. This is something we struggle with in core WordPress releases, where sometimes we do something, and then it might be the beta part of the cycle when things are supposed to be more locked down, and we start using it, and we're like, huh. The earlier you can get that daily usage, the better. So decoupling the development from core ended up being the best thing, and I think provides an interesting model for 3.8. Now, the most surprising thing I'm going to tell you about 3.8 is that it features Luke Skywalker. Now, don't worry, we're not moving away from our jazz naming scheme. But 3.8 is going to start tomorrow, the same day as 3.7. We're going to start the development at the same time, and we're aiming for a release at the beginning of December. Now, we're either going to or die trying. And it's very much the same things that we're sort of pioneering with 3.7, we're going to try to apply with 3.8. So smaller teams, quicker iterations, fewer bottlenecks, and temporary hooks. So in 3.7, all the development of all new features will be done as independent units, as plugins. And each one of those plugins will try to follow the model I just outlined of what we sort of stumbled upon working for MP6. There'll be a clear leader. People can get commit really easily to the plugin. There'll be releases as frequently as possible. And there'll be kind of things you can play around with and use. If you think about it, it's kind of, remember when we used to talk about canonical or core plugins? It's kind of turning that whole idea on its head. So instead of saying there's these less important features that aren't good enough for core, but we're still going to kind of maintain them like core, we're saying these are the most important things for core. And we're going to develop them in a way that can be as inclusive and open as possible to see what happens. I'm excited about this because two of the things that can be headlines for the 3.8 release are already pretty far along, and that's the MP6 plugin, which, again, you can download and use today, especially if you love Phogos and Papyrus, and the 2014 theme, which I would like to make a change in actually releasing. I want to go to more of a car company model, releasing 2014 before 2014 is mostly over. When you think about it, there's kind of a loop for core contributors. And it perhaps looks something like this. You have an idea, you patch it, you get review and feedback, and it gets included, and then you throw a party, and then you have another idea, you patch it, et cetera, et cetera. There's many places where this leaks right now, though. And I think that moving, like, for example, by the 3,800 track tickets that are open, some number of track tickets that don't even have a review or a response yet. If we can tighten that, I think that'll be a lot more engaging for people to be involved. Oh, the other thing I almost forgot about, with actually a 3.7 thing, we're changing how components work in WordPress. So right now we have, 60 components? 60 components, we're moving that to 90. But there's only going to be, many of those will be subcomponents. There will only be about 35 top-level components. A component is kind of a logical section of the WordPress code base. So a component might be commenting, or it might be the WYSIWYG, or something like that. So we're moving that in. And the idea is that someday, each one of these components could be like its own team with leads and everything like that, just like Core does. Furthermore, we're changing it so that you can subscribe just to a single component, because following the fire hose of track and comments and everything like that, it has gotten pretty big. And you might not need to follow everything, so you'll be able to subscribe just to the stuff that has to do with that. So, well, I already talked about what's coming in 3.8. I said when. The bomb, the thing behind the data that I think that is sort of the danger and what we need to move faster to address. This is just some data from WordPress.com. Of 50,000 blogs that were created, let's say, 7 days ago, only about 4% of those are going to be active today. So we're having a 96% attrition rate of people that are starting a blog. We think this is actually higher for WordPress.org users because there's the additional sort of steps and things around plugins and themes. That's a lot. So the good news and bad news. Bad news is 96% of people aren't sticking around with their blog. The good news is there's still a huge number coming in the door every day. So, you know, the numbers, absolute numbers go up in the ways that we've talked about. But the other good news is that 4% is ridiculously low. We can improve that a lot. And if we do, when I'm on stage next year, the numbers will be much, 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 much higher than we've talked about, and we'll be that much closer to our goal of democratizing publishing on the web. So this is not going to be easy. It's a huge challenge, but I think we can do it. One of the things that came through, and how are we going to do it? One of the things I talked about MP6 was, like I said, it was kind of that coat on the paint on the wall, coat of paint on the wall. So about a month ago, I went to the designers and said, well, if you weren't constrained by sort of our charter, which was only changing the aesthetics, what were some things you would do to the WordPress admin? And just have a couple of these right here in terms of different layouts. And I'm going to show you my very favorite one in terms of menus, WYSIWYG. So what if there's an idea like, for example, instead of post formats being something that applies to a whole post, it's something that you can have multiple in a post, and you can drag and drop and rearrange. So inserting a map, a quote, an image, a gallery with a set of images would just be as easy as that. Ideas like this, I think, are the kinds of things that we can explore in plugins that would be difficult to in Core. If for nothing else, then we'd be worried about breaking something. One of the main reasons that we had trouble doing some of the resolution independent stuff in Core prayer was we kind of got stuck on thinking, well, how are we going to do the font files and embedding that and licensing it and linking it and everything like that? And sometimes major developments can get lost in those sort of weeds of implementation. I think we can turn that on its head. And the good news is that there's never been a better time to get involved with WordPress. This model is going to open it up quite a bit. I think WordPress has been successful so far, not because of some magic features it has, like some competitors believe when they copy us. It's been successful because we've never been satisfied with our process. And as a community, we've been maniacally focused on improving things for you guys here in the audience, the user. It's been great. That process has allowed us to serve 18% of the web so far and be one of the last remaining stalwarts of the sort of independent web. But you know, for any of you who have ever complained about, say, a social network selling your personal data to an advertiser or policies that you disagree with in terms of service or anything like that, be the change that you want to see on the web. Get involved with WordPress and contribute, whether it be through support, documentation, code, design, whatever it is. And we can make this change. If we don't do it, I don't think anyone is. And that sort of way of thinking is why, now a decade later, I still feel like WordPress is just getting started. So thank you very much.